Welcome, everyone, to Lead Generation World Podcast. I am happy to have you back with us again today. We got a great show planned. We've got Matt Conlin from Fluent with us today. Really great story of entrepreneurship and leadership in the advertising and performance marketing world. So sit tight. That's going to be a great interview. It's coming up soon. Before we bring on Matt, I do want to remind you that we've got Lead Generation Week happening. Actually, the app goes live on April 27th on Monday, maybe when this video is actually distributed. You'll be able to interact with hundreds of other lead generation professionals on the app. And then we've got a week full of content and great sessions planned for the last week of May. So that's Memorial Day week, and it'll be a great opportunity to watch some great content while you're all at home and taking a breather from maybe some other things that are going on. So be sure to go sign up for that. You can go to leadgenerationworld.com and click up on the top link. There's going to be a Lead Generation Week link up there, and you can click on that and it'll take you to the right place. But thank you again for joining us. If you want any more information about Lead Generation World or being on the podcast, be sure to shoot me an email at mike@leadgenerationworld.com and we'll take it from there. But otherwise, let's go ahead and bring Matt in and have get the conversation going. All right. Welcome to the Lead Generation World Podcast. My name is Mike Faree. We got a great guest today with us. We got Matt Conlin from Fluent. Matt, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Michael. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you. Yeah. You know, we met at Lead Generation World in January for the first time, but I know we've probably crossed paths many, many times in the lead ecosystem and all the different conferences and shows. So it's nice to connect with you. You know, Fluent's got a pretty cool story that I really wanted to kind of dive into and learn more about you. And, you know, then we can dive into all the products and services that you guys provide. But maybe just kind of kick it off and give me the story about sort of how Fluent was founded. Because when I look at your LinkedIn profile, you know, out of college, you got right into the digital advertising space. But how did it come about, founding your own company?
Yeah, well, we've got I like to think it's a pretty interesting origin story, somewhat unique, but it started in 2001. I actually moved to New York from Michigan, from Ann Arbor, Michigan, decided I was going to go to St. John's University because I really liked their basketball team in the 90s when I was in high school. And, you know, there was a lot of burgeoning hip hop artists I was listening to at the time, and they were all coming out of Jamaica, Queens. And so I said, you know, I'm going to school in Queens, mom and dad. And they're like, what? Okay. Anyways, that my first week of school, I actually met what would come turn out to be my business partner, Ryan Schulke. And so first week of school at St. John's, we hit it off. And actually,
how did you guys meet? How did you meet? Was it just in passing or in a class?
Just in passing. It, you know, it was kind of random because we're in the same dorms at St. John's campus in Queens. And it just so happened I was from Ann Arbor, Michigan. He was a kid from Long Island. Both of us liked the Michigan Wolverines, and both of us were really into Mobb Deep. And so that was that sparked it. And from that point forward, though, I think both of us had a bit of an entrepreneurial bug that couldn't seem to shake. And so we started a couple different businesses in college, and one of which that one of our more successful was a music business. And we started selling mixtapes or mixed CDs back then, when everyone was carrying Discmans around campus. And it turned into a nice little enterprise. You know, we were going to Canal Street. We were getting wholesale mixtapes from the hottest New York City DJs. We were selling them on campus in the cafeterias and the dorms. And you know, it wasn't going to make anybody rich.
You just pile them all in the backpack and cruise around. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. We, you know, I'd like to say we started, you know, like a Napster type business, but no, bit more analog, bit more traditional than that. And, but yeah, you know, like I was saying, no one was really going to get rich off that endeavor, but we certainly had enough money for, you know, for beer and all other college essentials.
What was it like, two St. John's students going down to Canal Street and, you know, hawking some CDs?
Well, you know, I like to think that we had enough street savvy to ensure our safety in those moments. But it was good. It was actually a good place to cut your teeth, I think. And I think it was kind of what set us off on that path where both of us said, there's probably a better way to go about, you know, building a business. And so, you know, when we got out of college, you know, funny story, but I didn't think I was going to go here, but since we're on this topic, yeah. I moved back to Michigan right after I graduated. And I was flying back to New York that summer after school. This is the summer of 2005. I went on tons and tons of interviews with, you know, ad agencies and PR companies, book publishers. And I probably went on 15 different interviews. And one company gave me a shot. It was a company called Innovation Ads. And I came out of, I called Ryan, who was living in New York at the time. And I said, hey, I got a job. Can I sleep on your futon? And
so you were in Michigan. You were in Michigan applying for jobs in New York.
Yeah, I was applying, and I was flying back like once a month. And I'd line up five interviews every Friday. I'd stay with my friend at the time, knock out five interviews, come back, and hope there's some good news so I could finally move back to New York. You know, and I couldn't get a job anywhere. And finally, Innovation Ads was like, yeah, well, would you like to start as a account executive and do digital ad sales, and. And when they said there was actually a salary involved and it wasn't just commission based, I was just thrilled. Now,
yeah.
Back in 2005, this was kind of early days. So think back, this is, you know, when Facebook was still, just exclusively for college students.
Yep. Yep.
Google had just bought DoubleClick. And so they were still building out their initial ad serving. Facebook wasn't even selling ads back then.
Yeah.
Snapchat was just a twinkle in the eye of its founder, of Evan. And so it was a good time to kind of enter the industry. Within a few months of joining Innovation Ads, I realized it was a incredible industry. As one of the early kind of performance marketing lead generation shops, they serviced the education industry quite extensively. They won some big agency of record deals, and I got some incredible exposure to the lead gen category at large. And within my first year at Innovation Ads, they got acquired by a private equity company. And it was around that time Ryan and I now started working together at Innovation Ads. He came in and joined. And after they got acquired, we were, two 21, 22-year-old kids. And we looked at each other and said, you know what? I think we could start a business. But we weren't sure where to start. And so we went to one of our mentors. And we said, we see these young guys. They started this company called Innovation Ads. They sold it. They're doing great things, incredible business. How do we start a company? And the sage feedback sage advice that we received that I'll never forget was, well, why don't you start a company in the space that you're in? Why don't you look at the industry that you're working in right now? And I think that was the aha moment that we needed, because we were thinking about getting back into music, or do we start a widget company? There was all these different ideas spinning around. It was at that point, there was the light bulb moment. It was like, oh yeah, let's just become students of the game and learn everything we possibly can about how to create a great performance marketing business, create a great lead generation business. And that's kind of how that all started.
So you went from Innovation Ads and then to another company, then Clash Media, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And so that's when, was that still focused on education, or was that different industries?
Yeah, so it was around... So was that during that period, so we went from, so we were actually thinking about starting our own business, and then we got the opportunity to launch the U.S. office for a UK-based company, that was Clash. And, we were given the opportunity to build the business from the ground up. We were given a lot of responsibility, had an opportunity to build the team, built the advertiser base, built the publisher base, build out the technology. And it was during that time that we... education was still in vogue. We'd built out a nice call center business. We're working with a lot of the big name schools and aggregators at the time. But we also, during that period, launched an ad serving solution. And at that ad serving product that we started to tinker with there, started to create a much larger opportunity that became into focus. And so, we had a great run. We built that business up to about a $25, $30 million run rate in just under 3 years. And when the CEO ended up getting kind of ran into some issues or expanding too rapidly overseas, Long story short, he left, and then we left the next day and launched Fluent. And when it came to launching Fluent, our initial thesis was pretty straightforward. You know, we had come from Innovation Ads, which was, you know, had a call center, but were largely, you know, a brokerage. So they were, you know, getting a deal and brokering it to a publisher. And we worked on some, you know, we saw the value in owning the media and owning the engagement with the consumer. And so when it came to launching Fluent, we said that brokerage model is just not sustainable. And we were, you know, we wanted to adhere to our obligation with Clash. We stayed away from the call center and education category. And we said, let's start with creating a great product and good foundational technology and create great experiences for the consumers. And if we start with the consumers and good product, the advertisers will come. And so when we finally launched Fluent in early 2010, we actually started as an ad serving solution. We were a custom SSP. So we were going to publishers. We were helping to monetize their post-registration inventory. And it was white space. There was a lot of publishers out there that were serving traditional banner ads. And we said, well, what about that registration experience? You've got millions of people registering on your site. What if you served an ad right after the registration? Right now, do you have a blank thank you page? And so we started getting some really big wins. We had Yahoo Fantasy Football was running our post-registration ad unit. We had Photo Bucket. We had Pandora at one point. So we had a mobile ad serving version of it too.
How'd you go about that? Wait, let me just stop you for a second.
Yeah, sure.
Because there's a couple things that come to mind when I think of really any business that's from inception, just very young. And when I think about ad space and the platform that you guys built out, it's almost like a chicken and egg thing too, right? You have to balance the publications and then also the advertisers, and which one comes kind of first is sometimes tricky, right? Because the publishers want to make sure that they're going to make money and the advertising to be there, and vice versa. So how did you guys balance that early on?
That is the fundamental question, right? Because you can't do everything at once. And so I think the way that we approached it is how do you solve for one side of that supply and demand equation at and just put that on and as your central focus. So, for example, at one point we put all the emphasis on how do we identify the right publishers that we know if we can get you, if we can monetize your traffic at this price point, can you send me your traffic? Will you integrate my ad serving technology? And once you got the yes there, then it became, all right, how do I find the right advertisers that I know are a good fit for this contextual environment or for this demographic that we know is on this site? And frankly, are going to be able to support the monetization agenda. And so, you know, it certainly was a chicken or the egg. So it depended throughout our history. There were sometimes there was a far heavier emphasis on publisher, but I'll tell you, there's one important difference between the way we started Fluent and a lot of my other experience in the industry. When we were engaging with advertisers, and this started very early on, we started with the end in mind. And so we'd start every conversation with, what is your ultimate goal? What is a customer worth to you? And, you know, if you're an auto insurance, and we knew that, you know, they could afford to pay $200 for a new policy. And so we'd have the frank conversation. We said, well, if we could generate a lead for $20 and they convert at 10%, this sounds like that's a pretty scalable opportunity. And so what was really important there is if we started with the end in mind and with the advertiser's needs first, we could create what we'd like to call as evergreen or always on programs. And so when we started developing those types of relationships with advertisers, we knew that as long as we deliver great quality and we're starting with like, this is ROI positive for that advertiser, we were able to say, okay, advertiser side's okay for the moment. Let's go and work on developing our products out, creating better consumer experiences, and then going after more publisher supply. And so at any given time, it was like, okay, now let's make sure we build out the advertiser base, get that steady, healthy. We're delivering great value to our partners there so we can invest more time on other elements of the business to enrich the overall value chain.
Yeah. Now, were you, obviously, I don't think you're a programmer or developer, right? And was your partner sort of more tech or developer on that side or neither?
Yeah. So the relationship we've always shared is, we like to say I'm a bit more outside of the house, focusing on partnership development, both advertiser and publisher side, kind of the marketing end, the sales end, and also just internal operations, working with the teams, making sure things are flowing, town halls are happening, and overall kind of business and team connectivity. And then my partner's always been more media side, focus on product and technology, and working very closely with our engineering and product teams to make sure that if we have a big opportunity with an advertiser or a publisher, that we can build out what's needed to support their needs.
How did you guys early on figure that, being able to support and develop that ad serving platform? Because it's not the most trivial thing out there. I mean, there's some complexity to that.
We found some incredible engineers and some incredible product support that were able to execute on the vision that was set out, and many of which we still work with today, right? Yeah. So it's been just an incredible relationship. We've had some of the strongest developers in the category, frankly, that we've had the good fortune of working with. And I think part of it too is the fact that we were based in New York, right? And yeah. Being based in New York, there's access to really great folks. And there's a lot of really good performance marketing companies that are all based here. And so, we worked at a couple companies in the category, and during those experiences met really smart people and said, hey, we're thinking about launching this new thing. Are you interested in coming along for the ride?
Yeah.
And the rest is history.
Yeah. And that was also about the time with good timing that education was starting to struggle too, right? They went through a whole ringer with the added magnification of pressure from the regulators and all this sort of stuff on EDU. But you guys around that time were saying, see you later, education, moving on to other verticals.
I'd like to say we saw it coming, but frankly, we wanted to limit our scope and our focus when we launched the business. And building out a call center and an education portal, all the things needed to support that category just weren't in it for us, weren't in the cards for us. And so, in 2010, we started, we said, education's not in our purview. And that turned out to be the right decision, because shortly after that, there was all those changes that the Obama administration brought down in the for-profit universities, and, massive change and a lot of bad debt hit. And we were fortunately not on the receiving end of it that time. So
yeah,
that was quite fortunate.
One of the things that we talked about this before too, but I'd like to revisit it, is that a lot of companies think that things are duplicatable across multiple industries, and some don't. Some go, this is my niche, this is how I work in education or mortgage or insurance, whatever it may be. What's your sort of overall viewpoint of the being able to duplicate different campaigns across different industries and the ability for lead generators to do that? Is it a matter of just mechanics and, duplicating it over to another industry, or is it more than that?
Yeah. I think there's a couple great examples, publicly traded companies in the category that I think that have managed through that exact challenge quite well. I think about LendingTree, QuinStreet as perfect examples. Not public, but like the Red Ventures and Centerfields and some of the other folks have also managed through that quite well. And we've certainly done a good job, but I think at Fluent, but if we look at some of the longer standing examples, look at LendingTree, I think is a good one. They started off with a particular focus on mortgage and refinance and got exceptionally good at servicing those consumers, providing great value, creating a great brand for consumers. First thing you think about when thinking about refinancing your home or buying a new home and need a mortgage is, I need to check out LendingTree. And only after they had that firm base established could you go out and expand into other verticals. And I think the same thing for us. Any time that we've tried to attack too many verticals at once, naturally, every single one of them fails. And so while today Fluent is highly diversified, we support performance marketing, customer acquisition efforts for advertisers across a variety of categories and industries, including financial services, home services, media and entertainment, nonprofit, consumer packaged goods, and retail. If we had tried to start to service all those categories at once, I can guarantee they would have failed. But I think what we've done quite well is, and what we like to pride ourselves on is, there is typically commonality in the way that smart marketers approach performance and media buying and data acquisition. And usually you can apply principles that work in one category to another. So, you know, for instance, if we found great success in auto insurance, for instance, and the way that they're approaching acquiring, you know, consumers for, you know, new auto insurance products, the same principles that are being applied there can serve quite well in the mortgage refinance category or other insurance products for that matter, including health and life and so on and so forth. So, you know, I think, you know, how do you leverage the skill sets and the learnings from category A and apply it to a new category has been, I think, one of the skill sets we've developed over the years. And I think one thing that we've gotten quite adept at in recent years is there's extremely sophisticated marketers coming out of the mobile app category that are using great technology to better measure not just the upstream conversion action, right? So someone installing the app, but all the subsequent actions. And they're not shy about sharing that information back in a privacy first anonymous way, but it allows their partners to optimize better and create better programs that deliver better return on ad spend. And so how, as going back to the point, how do you take some of the principles that the mobile app industry has really owned and developed great expertise around and apply that to consumer packaged goods, for instance, or apply it to you know, financial services? Sure, there's a technical requirement in making sure that the right infrastructure is in place and that you're working with the right attribution partner. But if you can take that know-how and apply that different categories, we've found it works incredibly well. And again, it always starts with the end in mind, right? And what is the ultimate goal? What is the LTV? And ultimately, what's your CAC? What can you afford to pay for this customer? And if I can deliver that, does this program work at scale?
Yeah, no, that's great. And so, you know, you guys are coming up on your 10-year anniversary, I think. Sure. And going from, you know, guys, you know, two guys through college, and starting your own company, and maybe probably just a handful of you at first. And now I think you're at 200 and you're public. I mean, you know, that's, you know, tell me about that journey just a, you know, a little bit about, you know, going from that to where you are today. I mean, it almost to some people would think be unfathomable, you know?
Yeah, it's been a wild ride. Lots of learning experiences throughout it. Yeah, so you're right. We're coming up on 10 years. We started in kind of end of Q3, early Q4 of 2010. But yeah, so we launched the business. We experienced really incredible scale. You know, we started off as a performance marketing company, and you know we've really delivered and kind of just evolved our early concept. But when we go to market, it's all about starting with we developed one of the largest pure play performance platforms in the industry. And so what I mean by that is advertisers are able to bid on the actions that they want. And that might be on, you know, of course a click, but it could be on someone signing up for a lead form, someone filling out, you know, an application, could be even making a purchase. And so, you know, from the very beginning, it was how do we create great experiences for advertisers, great monetization for publishers. And we committed to just creating a great organization with great people. And that's really carried us through. So years kind of the first year, we did about $4 million in revenue. By year two, 2011, we finished that year at $40 million in revenue. So we shot out of a cannon. and that gave us the capital we needed to reinvest into people and start to build up the team, build up the infrastructure, build up the technology. And by 2012 and 13, you know, our core ad serving business we were talking about earlier, we recognized that there was a need to ultimately become the publisher. There was a lot of complexity in managing the ad serving business and a lot of inconsistency in you know, how we are serving ads. And so we wanted to eliminate that and create some standards. And ultimately wanted to own the user experience. And by doing so, becoming the publisher, creating that first party relationship with the consumer and capturing first party insights would ultimately serve us quite well down the road. Now back then we didn't realize the cookie was going to crumble as much as it has, but you know, so again, I think we right place, right time, right decision. But ultimately, you know, we went through a really meteoric rise in the first few years. And by the end of 2015, we got acquired by a publicly traded company called IDI. Through that transaction, we actually went public. They were a public company. They acquired us into a public entity. And, you know, we continued to grow. We made some acquisitions during that period. You know, throughout that, you know, we continued to build out a really strong team. And And I think that's really what helped us maintain our growth rate, maintaining, you know, positivity throughout all that. But, you know, throughout after the following the acquisition, we just realized it wasn't a great fit with our parent company. And so we started exploring some alternative options and went through an auction process, which is quite grueling, and I don't recommend it for the faint of heart. But you know, we had a lot of bidders at the table. The highest bidder was a company called Blue Focus, the largest ad agency based in China. Deal was signed. You know, the great valuation of the business just 2 years after getting acquired. And ultimately in February of 2018, it was blocked by the US government for concerns around, you know, they didn't like the concept of a US company being owned by a Chinese company. There was a lot of similar deals are getting blocked. The Trump administration was not cool with the Chinese owning any sort of US assets, especially ones that engage with a lot of consumers at scale. So ultimately, it was contemplated though during that transaction that they were going to spin out our parent. So we ended up, when the deal got blocked, we continued with the split from our parent company. And as of March 2018, we became a standalone public company on NASDAQ. And it was kind of random, but now 2 years later, we're managing through public markets for better or for worse. And it's been an incredible experience. And
what was that like, that learning curve, you know, going from a privately held company, you know, running your now public?
You know, well, like? I'll tell you one of the things I'll share that I would recommend every entrepreneur thinks about and considers is that, you know, we were entering a space that, you know, there was a lot of big players and we just, you know, we knew that there was opportunity in the category. We certainly weren't sure that we were going to get to this size and scale. But after we got the initial business concept off the ground, we were, you know, break even or profitable and growing. We made a bold move and put together an advisory board, and we used that to hold ourselves accountable. And even though we didn't have outside investors, there was no formal board requirement to have quarterly board meetings. We had them anyways. And that ultimately, that accountability, that rigor that we applied to our business practice and the way that we went about managing our business ended up paying off in spades. We started that in, I want to say, early 2012. And so, you know, having that quarterly meeting forced us to just always step back every single quarter and say, we got these issues. I don't have time to think about, take a step back. And every time you did, you're like, oh wait, I missed something. Or look at what we've been working on, and then, you know, resetting. So by the time we were bigger. We'd already established some foundational business management practices with not only how we manage the business, but how we communicate that to the team and how we communicated priorities, strategic imperatives out. And so that helped in ensuring that, you know, it wasn't just Ryan and I running a business. We had an entire team that was all rowing in the same direction. And frankly, without the capable team members that Fluent has had the good fortune of working with over the years, we wouldn't be where we're at. We've had a great team that's been able to really do decision on the plan. And so when we made that transition from private to public, it was business as usual. It's like, we have a job to do. We have expectations to deliver on. You know, historically, it was about delivering great results for our advertisers, delivering performance for our publishers, and delivering great experiences for consumers. And we hit numbers so that we can all remain. And now we have additional responsibility. We have to service shareholders, right? So it's just add one more constituent to our folks are responsible for, but nothing really changed. Then there's some added costs, right? Because it's the public markets and so on and so forth. But it was a massive transition, a lot of learnings, but I think we set ourselves for success by just putting in some good business fundamentals early on.
You know, one of the interesting things about your company, obviously, you know, starting from scratch and going to 200 plus employees seems like a daunting task. I mean, when you look, you know, there's a ton of lead gen guys out there, some of them working, a lot of them working from home, a lot of them one, two-man shops, and can't even fathom, you know, that type of growth plan, but dream of it and want to do that thing. I mean, any advice for these guys?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think you look at the, you know, our story as a good example. We started with just, you know, in a railroad apartment in Queens. And, you know, when we first started getting the business off the ground, there were six guys in a shared office space. And I think we've obviously had phenomenal success. We've bootstrapped and scaled from zero to, you know, over $250 million in revenue. But I think the big question is, you know, how do startups, how do those guys that have an idea or just getting off the ground, how do you compete in the land of giants, right? You've got the Facebooks and Googles of the world, the Amazons, the big players in our in lead generation category, and it seems daunting. But I think knowing that the little guy and when you're just starting off, you don't have the resources nor the cash to compete at that level, it's about resourcefulness. How do you find those pockets of opportunity where you can accelerate, right? And I think, you know, one example would be, you know, when everyone was running towards education, when we were first starting Fluent, we were running towards launching in new categories, right? And I think, you know, this idea of just being highly resourceful, looking for those opportunities in the marketplace and maybe those areas where everyone hasn't quite discovered yet. And when you do identify an opportunity, hit it really hard. I think that's been, some of the opportunity that, that, you know, young guys first starting off can take advantage of.
Yeah. And I guess, like, you know, at some level, a lot of guys get in their own head, right? And have a hard time getting out in front of the way of themselves.
Yeah. Well, and I think this is a point I always like to reference, but you've got, you know, call it $120 billion, $140 billion in ad spend in the U.S. alone, digital ad spend, that is. Google and Facebook take 60 cents on the dollar off the board right away. Okay. So, but in $120 billion category, that means there's still north of, call it $60 billion, $50 billion up for grabs. Right. And so when we talk about identifying those areas of opportunity, there is enough for the guy that's just starting off to eat, the gal, the girl, the guy, everybody to take advantage of the opportunity. And, the digital advertising is a phenomenal place to start your career. And even if you're in a career, it's a great place to start a new one, right? There's just, you know, the rules are still being written.
One of the other things I think of as a, young entrepreneur and the challenges that arise, aside from going public and all this sort of stuff, but it's the scaling of a company culture and trying to formulate what that culture is. I mean, how did you guys sort of take, what's your approach at Fluent now for having, 200 employees versus six, and how do you keep that ball and tight?
Yeah. So, we've had a couple, I'll give you a little insight into our business strategy, but when we started this business, we didn't have a grand vision for having, 200 plus employees being publicly traded and going through a couple exits. It was more about how do we create a good business and how do we get better every single day? We have an expectation for everybody that joins the Fluent team that, that you will get better every single day. You're going to develop your personal skill sets, your professional skill sets, and you're going to be stronger, a month from now than you are today. And if the collective is focused on becoming stronger and focusing on perpetually optimizing and developing new talent, skills, and educating themselves, we will advance the organization and hopefully the industry, right? And I think that's been something that's served us really well is, everyone, whether your tenure at Fluent is 10 years or 5 years, you will be stronger when you leave than when you started. And that's just a commitment that we make to every single employee. We are going to invest into you, into your education, into your skill development, into your professional development. And I think that's served us well, and it's helped us create just an incredible team, incredible culture. And we hold the culture really dear, right? It's something we really try and nourish through the events we put on. And actually, next week, I think we're going to try and put on lead gen trivia night or something to that effect.
Yeah.
I'm open to using some of the things that we do internally and sharing out the industry. The other thing I'll share that I think has been just one of the pillars of stability and one of the core tenets of our organization is this notion that what one does in the face of adversity ultimately determines your destiny. It's true in business. It's true in life. And in performance marketing and lead generation, there is always going to be challenges we're met with. And it's just the nature of the animal. And I think the more that you can prepare yourself, and you can anticipate those obstacles and make a plan to work through those obstacles, the better off you're going to be. Because Fluent sure has had its share of challenges. We'll continue to have our share of challenges. There's always going to be ebbs and flows in the industry. And I think that the more, you know, that concept of resiliency and making sure that you're able to, you know, fight through those challenges are what made it all the difference, right? There was many times in our past where we were hit with some very significant challenges. And I think if we didn't have the team we have and the culture we've developed and that notion of, you know, fighting through adversity, we certainly would not be where we're at today. And, you know, I can't stress that enough. And I'd encourage, you know, entrepreneurs are just starting off to embrace some of those concepts of, you know, constantly learning, constantly be growing, but, you know, anticipate that when the sun's shining, it will start raining at some point in the near future. So be prepared.
Yeah. With regards to like sort of looking at the industry as a whole, I was asked a question the other day of what, you know, where I thought where the lead gen industry was going to be in a number of years. And I'm kind of curious to pose that question to you since you've been on, at least on the ad serving side, you know, in the business for 10 years, you've sort of seen a lot of the mechanics of what's happening, even with the big boys like LendingTree and QuinStreet. And you've seen either the evolution or maybe lack thereof of the evolution. Where do you sort of see performance marketing, you know, in 10 years from now? Because I don't know if there's going to be a whole lot of change in 2 or 3 years, but maybe there is. But, you know, what do you see it in 5, 10 years? Do you see any evolution at all?
Yes, but it's going to require groupthink and group effort. And I'll go back to something you started this meeting with or this podcast with rather.
Yeah.
We got the chance to meet in person at the Lead Gen World show that you hosted in Denver, which I thought was great. And it was actually I had been spending a lot of time building out business lines and new verticals, building out gaming and media entertainment, so streaming services. And meanwhile, we've had a incredibly strong lead generation practice for many years in financial services, education, a few other categories. And I realized that we hadn't, I don't think we've invested as much as we could or should have been into just the lead gen category at large. Mm-hmm. And so going to your show is a great eye opener that there's great companies, some really talented and smart people. And if we actually bring the collective together to advance the industry, there's a lot that can be done in the course of a decade. And, you know, we're fortunate to join Leeds Council. I think you introduced me to Rob Seaver over there. We joined Leeds Council. And I think just in my early discussions with some of the board members there, I've been really impressed. And I think the notion of us getting serious about best practices and creating experiences that are great for consumers and great for the industry at large, thinking with the privacy first cap on, and making sure that like everything we're doing is aligned with, you know, let me actually say this a little bit differently.
Yeah.
I think that the Leeds Council has an opportunity in a future state to become a self-governing organization, right? And if we're successful in becoming self-governing, and that's recognized by federal and state authorities, And the only way we get there, though, is if we are creating best practices for the industry that everyone adheres to. And if you want to play in the industry as a publisher, as an advertiser, we need you to adhere to these best practices and guidelines that we've set out. And then and only then do I think we can make some significant steps forward as an industry and as an organization, is if we're all playing by a leveled up set of rules, right? And I think one of the challenges we've dealt with in this industry is that the rules are constantly changing. There are, you know, TCPA was not a thing when I first started, and it's, you know, you have to have good consent or else you can get nailed to the wall, right? And I think that's been, you know, an area that will continue to change. GDPR, CCPA, these are all things that we as lead gen marketers, especially when you're talking about contacting a consumer via phone or SMS or remarketing to them across addressable channels, you got to make sure you have the right consent. And so, you know, I think, how do you make sure that, you know, everyone's playing by a leveled up set of rules and we're organizing our collective muscle to push the industry forward?
Yeah.
So I think that's part of it. The other part of it is, you know, you go back to the initial business thesis we had around, you know, starting with the end in mind, and right, this notion of creating, you know, more scalable solutions for marketers. I think you're going to see a rise in advertisers wanting to de-risk spend. I mean, you look at what's happening right now as a result of the coronavirus and the pandemic. You've got the first advertisers to stop spending that were those that were spending in unaccountable channels, right? Those that were spending on the branding dollars, yeah. Right? So out of home got clipped really early on. Print is suffering pretty significantly. Even, you know, traditional TV and even some display has been impacted severely. However, who's still spending? Performance marketers, lead generation marketers, folks that know that, hey, when I spend a dollar, I'm making a dollar back. And I think that you're going to see more of that. There's going to be a lot of learnings that come out of this that will move even more into performance mentality. And, you know, that notion of prevent customer acquisition solutions is absolutely key. You know, something we announced just last 2 weeks ago now is we acquired a 50% stake in a company called Winopoly. The founder, a guy named Luciano, he was of college bound. That sold Class A to experience entrepreneur, you know, has a wealth of experience and best practices around call centers. And this notion of creating better experiences for our consumers, but also for clients, can we take that consumer further down that path to purchase, that consideration journey, and provide, you know, a full qualified consumer is the name of the game for the lead generation industry, right? And I think that has massive opportunities vertical. So yeah. I think that you're going to see more of that over the next decade. But I'll go back to the point. If we industry band together and level up best practices and make sure that everyone who wants to play in performance and lead gen is adhering to those, we can all move forward together. Rising tide raises all boats. And I'm a firm believer of that.
Yeah. I could dig in a little bit more to that, but I want to take, cause I don't want to take too much of your time here today, but going back to Clash and being from, I think they're a UK based company, right? And you mentioned GDPR. We have Lead Generation World actually is going to be in London in October. Yep. All things assuming, you know, we get out of this issue with coronavirus. But what from a Fluent perspective, or even just your own opinion, how do you see, you know, the European marketplace and the UK marketplace, their evolution, where they're at today?
Oh, that's a great question. So you've got.
Do you guys see it as an opportunity there?
Yeah, so we've been active in the UK market for since early 2018. It's been a really strong market for us. We're now expanding into other European markets, and I think there's a lot of opportunity out there. I would say that it is so different from the US. Every single country has its own privacy restrictions. You know, while everyone adheres to GDPR, Germany has its own set of rules and regulations, right? And so there is a significant cost and barrier to entry because from just a legal perspective, to make sure that you have the right data privacy and data best practices in place, that in and of itself is a tall order. And I think once we as an industry can get past some of those, we're playing by the new guidelines and new rules that are set out by the European lawmakers, then there's a lot of opportunity. But it's getting past that initial barrier to entry that I think is going to be limiting for a lot of folks that say, oh, great, Europe looks like a great place to expand. There is a lot of diligence that needs to go into expanding into those markets. But I'd say once we get past that, there's certainly a lot of growth to be had for sure.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I've noticed with talking to a lot of individuals is that they seem, from a technology standpoint, a transparency standpoint, they seem a few years behind the U.S. to some extent, maybe. I don't know if you would agree to that.
I wasn't going to say that, but that you said that, not me.
Well, I know it can come off maybe negative, but I actually think it as more positive and an opportunity for very quick learning for the UK and the advertisers there to take some of the best practices that have already been laid out in the US and companies that have sort of figured out that sort of thing and then apply it over into that marketplace. So I see it as a positive. Absolutely. For opportunity.
100%.
But yeah, it just seems, and that's why, frankly, Lead Generation World is going there, to provide a conference or an area where those best practices continue to be built up and supported with an industry event.
I was really excited for the London event in October, by the way, and now I'm not sure if that's going to happen, or even if it does happen, if I'm going to feel comfortable flying out there. I don't know.
I know it's really crazy. I hope by October, it's October 18th, 19th, and 20th. So I sure hope by then that we're at a point as a world that where we're relatively comfortable with travel or even just going to a conference. We have a number of US companies that are going to be there, or have said they're going to be there, but it is a very, UK and European based event as well. But yeah, it's a challenge. And so, we'll see what develops over the next couple months. Let me ask you just one other question about the evolution of lead gen. You talked about sort of best practices and standards, but I have a sense that you are sort of on also the edge of, from a tech and ad serving sort of standpoint. Where do you see it from the processes of traffic generation and capturing that traffic and then, potentially delivering it to the end user? Do you see that sort of process evolving at all, or is that sort of the mechanics relatively all going to stay the same?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is going to be data security, data privacy, right? Even with whether it's providing data, I mean, I'll give you a little bit of an example, but last year, Fluent embarked on an effort to essentially audit a lot of our partners' practices and how they were not only handling the data, but how they're dialing upon it. And, we kind of looked at what were their best practices? Were they in line with some new guidelines that we had set forth? And any folks that couldn't adhere to that, we just had to make a call that we could no longer work with them. And I think you're just going to see more of that. I think advertisers are going to get more critical with, putting in place the tracking software necessary to make sure that the consent is actually taking place, the actual passing of any sort of data is happening in a secure environment. I think what Jornaya, what Active Prospect, and folks like that are doing to help marketers get a sense of comfort that what they're buying is being done in a compliant, in transparent way is just incredible and is helps the industry move forward. But I think even when it comes to driving traffic, it's going to be, can you do it in a compliant way? Are you getting the right types of consent? Is the right intent there? I think we'll continue to see progress being made and new technologies being developed to support better transparency and better compliancy for sure.
Yeah. Okay. So I lied. I got one other thing. I came across Fluent Pulse, which is really, really cool stuff. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah. So, I'll give you a little background, but, so the Fluent business today, I mentioned this, but, Fluent's developed one of the largest pure play performance marketplaces in the US for sure, possibly the world. We engage with millions of consumers every single day. They're coming to our sites where we're helping consumers earn, save, and win. As part of our experience, we have a survey, and we use that survey to learn more about what our consumers' needs are, what they're in market for, what types of products and services that might be beneficial to them. And through that process, we also can capture in the market insights. And so we're surveying more Americans every single day than probably anybody else out there. We use a lot of the insights to inform ad serving methodology, right? So, simple concept is if somebody just bought a car, and are you in market for auto insurance? Yes, great. Here's an auto insurance ad, right?
Right.
But topical issues that can help inform, in this case, we want to make sure that local governments, first responders and other folks in the front lines know how the American consumer is feeling. So at this point, we've engaged with and surveyed over 4 million Americans. We are updating our results every single week on fluentpulse.com. The latest update was we actually, when this first started, so late March, we asked the American public how they felt Trump was handling, how they felt his response to the pandemic was. And now we've asked it almost 30 days later, and it's interesting to see the change in sentiment, So consumers are feeling a lot better about the way that the White House and the Trump administration is handling the pandemic. And it seems like consumer confidence is actually increasing. And so every single week we're getting updates. It's interesting. We already know what folks are, what states are planning on voting for which candidate. So there's a lot of really interesting capabilities, but I would encourage everyone who's listening to check out fluentpulse.com. Some incredible insights, and, you know, really, really great, insights that can help, you know, everyday Americans, but also folks that are, you know, thinking about how to best support communities in need. I mean, I think one of the things that shocked me was, the difference in unemployment, right? I mean, we've seen the stats, but we were asking consumers, have you been impacted financially or have you lost your job? When this first happened, the percentages were pretty low, and it's increased dramatically in the recent weeks. And I think the latest stat is after last week when 5 million plus Americans filed for unemployment, we're up to 22 million now. And you know, this is the, you know, unemployment rates at 18% is the highest we've seen since the Great Depression. You know, just put that in perspective. And so how do we make sure that we're still hearing from the American consumers that are engaging on our sites at scale and find out what are your needs? How can we help best support you? And are there ways that we can create experiences that are still providing value in your lives? Or are you in need? And if so, can we help support?
Yeah. All right. With all that information, those data and those opportunities to get questions, are you getting, you know, different research companies coming to you looking for that data? And are you guys looking at sort of providing more projections and
I don't know what I can actually share, but we're working with a couple organizations to do some joint research efforts, and those are underway right now. So I think, you know, keep an eye out on our LinkedIn page, on my LinkedIn page, and on Fluent Pulse, because we'll be sharing out some of those joint projects in the very near future. And honestly, I'd welcome the opportunity to partner with other folks in the kind of performance marketing and lead generation community where we might be helpful and be able to partner together on some of these efforts to support, you know, American consumers and frankly global consumers. And you know, we'd welcome the opportunity to partner. So I'd offer that up.
Well, Matt, thank you for spending the time with me again today, talking about Fluent. It's a really great story, and frankly, I could probably ask you 100 more questions, but I want to be respectful of your time. Hopefully, we'll be able to catch up again soon at one of the conferences when this whole thing is over, and I'll see you in the hallways again. If anybody wants to get a hold of you, they can. I assume they just head out to fluent.com or hit you up on LinkedIn would be appropriate.
Yeah, fluentco.com or LinkedIn are great places to reach us. And I hope this was helpful, insightful, lovely speaking with you, and you know, excited to kind of keep pushing the industry forward.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Thanks again, Matt.
Yeah, thank you.